Let me start with the policy dynamic. I was really intentional about providing the caveat of we really did not elect politicians to go to DC and give us holidays. Now, I say that because the same people who voted yes to Juneteenth as a federal holiday are the same people who voted no to the George Floyd Policing and Accountability Act. They're the same people who voted no to the John Lewis Voting Rights Act. They're the same people who voted no to equal pay for equal work. All right? So, as a policy expert, Senator, give us your breakdown of the significance and the insignificance of Juneteenth as a holiday, not as a movement, but as a holiday.
Well, thank you for this, Dr. Richey, and only on TYT are we gonna get this truth, the whole truth and nothing but the truth. So help us God. First, I definitely wanna shout out Mama Opal Lee, considered the grandmother of Juneteenth. She's been fighting for this, I believe, since the late 80s. Yep. She is in her 90s and she should be lifted for her perseverance and what she not only was trying to do, but what she has accomplished. And she's still out there on the front line. So I want to put that out there. Thank you, because she had a vision. Without her vision and her fight and having over 1 million people sign a petition, we would not have even gotten the holiday. And it is a symbolic reflection of unanswered business in these United States of America. And so on the policy side, Dr. Richey, as you have laid out, these same folks don't care that student debt is not canceled, which would have a positive impact on all working people, but particularly the Black community, and particularly Black women who hold the largest amount of student debt. These are the same folks that let the child tax credit expire. These are the same folks as Reverend Dr. Barber and his colleagues just marched on Washington just on Sunday. The Poor People's Movement, 140 million people living in poverty, Black people, this portion among those have a death. I mean, they just have a tin ear to those kinds of struggles. And so we do need policy fixes, not just some scraps, not just a celebration. And I mean that in not any disrespect to Mama Opal Lee, because see, Mama Opal Lee did what she was supposed to do. Now we need these other folks to wrap some stuff around this celebration so that we have real transformation for the African American community in this country, and that's economic transformation.
That's a great segue, Dr. Hamilton. You talk about economics in almost all of your lectures and how it connects back to policy and to decency of life. So Juneteenth, obviously a celebration of overcoming. But the reality of Juneteenth is rooted in the fact that they did not want enslaved Black folk or enslaved Africans to participate fully in the economic reality of America. That was the actual barrier. So let's talk about Juneteenth in the context of, do we still have a similar barrier in this modern construct where the powers that be, they don't want Black folk to have that kind of economic power in this country?
I mean, there's so many links that are going on today that we can go all the way back to the time in Galveston when the general entered and issued that field order. You know, for example, there's this narrative that Juneteenth is about Black people realizing that they're free. That's completely wrong. What Juneteenth was about in that instance was a military might that was able to enforce an emancipation. And similarly today, one could even argue our political movement that got us to the point where it's recognized as a holiday is sadly linked to all the atrocities that have taken place with George Floyd, with other examples that took place that has led to a recognition of some of the injustices. I guess the large point I'm trying to make is that the violence is not delinked from economics. It's not delinked at all. And as you astutely point out, that using violence to subjugate a people, keep them in their place, and even the threat of violence has direct implications on one's freedom. And one's freedom needs to be defined in terms of economic freedom. If it's not, it's not authentic. if we talk about freedom to vote, freedom to choose, you know, those are important human rights. But equally important as a human right is an economic right to a job, is an economic right to some income, is an economic right to some capital. And throughout American history, Black people have not been afforded the same access to these attributes. And what's worse, when they were able to accumulate by heroic efforts to get land, to get capital, it's never had the political codification that's been afforded to white people. In other words, the threat of violence or actual violence, the fraud, the malfeasance that takes place from the private sector without a political apparatus to protect a citizen from that has been our American history.
You know, there's always a front-leaning narrative, a public relations narrative that comes out of these historical events. When I tell my college students that the Emancipation Proclamation actually did not free all enslaved people, they look baffled. What Abraham Lincoln did is provided a proclamation specifically for places under Confederate control. And you had about four variations of America outside of Confederate control that still legally had slaves, okay? Once again, the public relations narrative says, wow, Abraham Lincoln freed all of the slaves. That's it. So let's run with that. You know why? Because that story's simple. It's binary, good, bad, right? That's he did it or didn't. But that's not the reality. It's very nuanced. Senator Turner, let's talk about the trickery even today of what seems to be good policy in the front, but on the back is bad policy. We see this with, for example, the celebration of Juneteenth. What has happened to Juneteenth? It has become massively commercial. So much so that they are selling damn ice cream with the word Juneteenth on it and not giving Black folk one dime. All right, so let's talk about that. Let's talk about the commercialization. What looks great in the front, however, may be a very problematic issue in the back.
Sure, and however they can profit. I mean, African-American, our culture, we dominate pop culture all over the world. So that's a whole nother statement. Like, I'm glad you brought up the fact that the Emancipation Proclamation, strong document, glad it happened. And it didn't happen by osmosis. It didn't happen because of the goodness of President Abraham Lincoln. It happened because Black folks pushed for that. People like abolitionist Frederick Douglass was in his ear. You know, that was the push. And there's a magnificent article that was written by Professor Kelly Carter Jackson in The Emancipator about exactly, you know, why is it that Lincoln, the title actually is Lincoln Gets Too Much Credit for Freeing Enslaved Black People. And I mean, she really breaks it down. But before I go there, Dr. Richey, and I want to answer your question, I want to go back. So the Emancipation Proclamation, as you laid out, only freed the slaves in the Confederacy, which at that time, because the Confederacy had split off, the North, or the president of the North, which was President Abraham Lincoln, he really had no legal authority over the Confederacy, not technically. So while it was a political ploy, and I'm not saying it wasn't a good political ploy, because sometimes you need good political ploys, we do need to understand that the slaves in the border states, because this is now tactical from a military perspective, the slaves in the border states did not reap the benefits of that Emancipation Proclamation. And that is a problem too. But let me go to General Order Number 3.
Come on.
That in Galveston, Texas, right? We got General Order Number 3. And it was brought there by General Gordon Granger. And it's very short, because I want people to understand what was happening. He said, the people, now this is written by the executive, right? The people are informed that in accordance with the proclamation from the executive of the United States, all slaves are free. This involves an absolute equality of personal rights and rights of property between former masters and slaves. And the connection, herefore, existing between them become that between employer and hired labor. The freed are advised to remain. Now, this is it. Y'all better write. Hey, get ready. The freed are advised to remain at their present homes and work for wages. They are informed that they will not be allowed to collect at military posts, and that they will not be supported in idleness, either there or elsewhere. I mean, what the hell? First of all, Black people have never been allowed to be idle. You know, I just want folks to wrap their minds around General Order Number 3. The relationship is now that of employer and seriously? Think about that. Now, even in that exact, it reinforces stereotypes about Black folks who built this joint, as my sister Angela, as my sister Angela Rye so clearly points out. Mm-hmm. So even in the doing of it, there is still this encapsulation through policy, through this executive order, that Black folks are somehow less deserving, that we don't work, that our idleness will not be supported. And that's the executive order that the general gave to tell people in Galveston, Texas, that they were free, air quote. Mm-hmm. This is serious. And this country continues to perpetuate. See, that General Order Number 3 is a perpetuation of what is happening right here in 2022.
Doc, I want you to opine on that.
Oh, man, I love that you read that, because it demonstrates the weaponization of race and the fact that our legal structure has never treated Black people the same as white people. And you actually reading the text made that clear. I mean, the point I was trying to make earlier is that even in the context of so-called freedom, and not a freedom to be idle, as you just talked about, and not a freedom to have mobility throughout society, because you still had that threat of bondage if you chose not to work. And you clearly laid that out. But it was the military might that came in and enforced it. And that's the point I want to make also, that it wasn't just a proclamation that was declared. It was a military might led by a general that came in and enforced Black people to even have that limited freedom in that context. And you know, that carries over today, and that's the point. I mean, we dehumanize people with a legal structure. We talk a lot about bigotry and hatred and all of that, which is a problem and should be addressed. But what is really pernicious is a state apparatus that enforces a property right in whiteness. And it could not have been said more clearly than you just reading the text from it the way you just did.